Gildan Media, a division of Recorded Books, presents Mergers and Acquisitions for Dummies by Bill Snow. Narrated by Stephen J. Cohen. Publisher's Note: Limit of Liability, Disclaimer of Warranty. While the publisher and author have used their best efforts in preparing this book, they make no representations or warranties with respect to the accuracy or completeness of the contents of this book and specifically disclaim any implied warranties of merchantability or fitness for a particular purpose. No warranty may be created or extended by sales representatives or written sales materials. The advice and strategies contained herein may not be suitable for your situation. You should consult with a professional where appropriate. Neither the publisher nor the author shall be liable for damages arising herefrom. Introduction. In every job, whether it be sales, managing retail establishments, raising capital, crunching numbers, writing, working with venture capitalists, creating online ventures, or working investment banking deals, I've done all these, by the way, you quickly discover that you need a whole new set of rules, lingo, conventions, and nomenclature. And more often than not, what you need to know to excel at your job can be distilled into just a few salient points. If you're lucky, you bump into a wise old sage who, upon experiencing your questioning, utterly confused face and dispirited body language, simply says, "Forget all that other stuff. Here's what you really need to know." Enter Mergers and Acquisitions for Dummies, an inside look at the process of buying and selling companies. Although companies change hands every day, buying and selling can mean many things and take many forms. Who or what is the buyer or seller? What kind of transaction is it? How will the buyer finance the deal? And what does the seller receive? These are only a few of the considerations in any given mergers and acquisitions, M&A, deal. It's so confusing. As a result, business owners, some of the main participants in M&A, are often completely befuddled when the time comes to sell their businesses or make acquisitions. They don't know anything about M&A because they've been focused on their own businesses and not on the business of buying and selling companies. That's why I wrote this book, to serve as your wise old sage as you jump into the wild M&A world. About this book. Although the M&A process, like any sales process, involves a step-by-step approach, I've written this book so you can simply refer to whatever section you need to read. When a buyer and seller are negotiating a deal, they're on opposite sides of the table. The buyer wants to get the best, that is, lowest price, and the seller wants to get the best, that is, highest price. This book isn't slanted one way or another. It's not pro-buyer or pro-seller. Deals get done only when buyer and seller find common ground and agree to price and terms. During the M&A process, many of the steps and techniques I discuss in this book apply to buyers, sellers, or both. I highly recommend sellers read the buyer's information and vice versa. My hope is that this book provides some insights for both sides by helping each side see things from the other's perspective. Understanding the other side's motivation and rationale is key to getting a deal done. If you know what the other side is seeking, or why she's asking for something in a particular way, you're in a better position to provide an answer that helps move the deal to a close. And closing deals, ladies and gentlemen, is what M&A is all about. conventions used in this book. I use a few conventions throughout this book to help make it more accessible. Because mergers and acquisitions is kind of an unwieldy phrase, I often use the abbreviation M&A. You see it in the field all the time anyway, so why not use it here? One challenge in this book is that two distinct yet related groups of people, buyers and sellers, may read this title. When I use buyer, I'm referring to the individual or executives in a company seeking to acquire another company. When I use seller, I'm referring to the owner of a company or the owner's representatives, executives or advisors. I also use you to address you, dear reader, directly, even though the text in question may not apply to your specific situation. In those cases, I clearly alert you to whether I'm talking about buyers or sellers. What you're not to read. My goal for this book was to write an easy-to-read introductory look at the world of mergers and acquisitions. At times, however, some of the text may be a bit technical and in-depth, so I turned those parts into sidebars or marked them with a technical stuff icon. You don't need to read those parts unless you really, 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 really want to know more. Foolish assumptions. I assume you bought this book for any number of reasons. You're a business owner or executive of a middle market or lower middle market company and are interested in selling a division, subsidiary, or entire company. You're an executive of a company and are interested in acquiring middle market or lower middle market companies. You're a business student who is interested in discovering more about mergers and acquisitions. You know a lot about your specific business, but little or nothing about the business of buying or selling businesses. You may be asking yourself, why the specific delineation of middle market and lower middle market companies? Those two market segments, defined roughly as companies of $250 million to $1 billion in revenue, middle market, and $20 million to $250 million in revenue, lower middle market, are often overlooked by larger banks. The deals aren't as large, the companies aren't as famous or sexy, and when you have a plethora of top-tier MBA grads all clamoring to make $1 million a year, the smaller fees from these smaller deals just aren't of interest. Although the lower middle market deals aren't front-page headline blockbusters, the fact is, the middle market and lower middle market are comprised of many more companies than the Fortune 500, which, when you think about it, is exactly 500 companies. The owners and executives of many, if not most, lower middle market companies are wholly unfamiliar with the business of selling a business and are therefore the perfect audience for this book. But although middle market and lower middle market company execs may be this book's target audience, the information here is applicable for just about any kind of business sale transaction. How this book is organized. I organized Mergers and Acquisitions for Dummies in five essential parts. These parts cover the main facets of doing deals, from an introduction to the basics, to the courting process, to the documents and meetings involved, to integrating buyer and seller. Part 1. Mergers and Acquisitions 101. Part 1 gives you the lowdown on M&A's foundations. Chapter 1 introduces you to some of the basic building blocks in the M&A world: words, phrases, decorum, players, and their motivations, and generally accepted steps to buying and selling companies. Chapter 2 analyzes the rationale and motivations of buyers and sellers so that you can better understand the folks on the other side of the table, and maybe get some insight into your own goals as well. In Chapter 3, I provide an outline of the generally accepted M&A process. You have a much better chance of making a successful deal when you know what steps to follow. Part 2. Taking the first steps to buy or sell a company. When you actually want to do deals, as opposed to merely thinking about doing deals, Part 2 gets you started on the first steps. You need money, or seashells, cigarettes, or some form of consideration that the seller finds acceptable. And Chapter 4 offers some thoughts about financing M&A deals. Every deal maker needs a little, well, a lot of help. So Chapter 5 lays out the advisors you need in order to successfully buy or sell companies. M&A is really a form of dating, except with meetings, boring documents, and grueling travel. Chapter 6 provides you with colorful tips for successfully approaching buyers or sellers and explains why M&A is one of the few industries where selling is easier than buying. Part 3. Starting the deal on the right foot. In this part, I show you how to get going on a deal. Chapter 7 quietly discusses the cloak and dagger world of confidentiality. Chapter 8 deals with the offering document, which is basically the story a seller tells a buyer about the company, as well as how to write it and what to look for when you review it. M&A requires a certain level of discretion, and that level is high. In Chapter 9, I introduce you to the form and function of the Indication of Interest, IOI. This field loves its initialisms. That buyer offers seller when buyer's ready to move from talking about doing a deal to providing specific thoughts on an actual deal. What can I say? M&A loves crafting documents too. The next steps are the management meetings between buyer and seller. Chapter 10 helps you navigate these meetings, which don't have fancy abbreviations, but can be tricky. Part 4. Firming up the deal. When buyer and seller agree to do a deal, what's next? Part 4's topics. That's what. First, buyer and seller have to agree to terms. M&A deals involve layer upon layer of complexity that you can and should negotiate. Chapter 11 takes you to the smoke-filled back rooms where deals are made. All cigar chomping is figurative. Chapter 12 plows the fields of valuation for you and reaps an answer to that most nagging of questions: what the heck is this company worth? When buyer and seller want to stop playing the field and get married, they move on to the letter of intent, LOI. Chapter 13 takes you through the ins and outs of this key document. Due diligence is the next key phase. It's where buyer and seller confirm certain facts from the other side just to be safe. Chapter 14 fills you in on what to expect during the confirmatory due diligence phase. Chapter 15 provides insight about converting the LOI and the results of due diligence into a final binding purchase agreement. Part 5. Closing the deal and beyond. Part 5 helps you successfully conclude the deal. In Chapter 16, you get the insider's look at that important day. Chapter 17 details all the sordid adjustments one side or the other makes after the closing. After the deal is done and a new day has risen, buyer and seller must integrate and learn to live together. Integrating buyer and seller can be a difficult proposition that many people don't think about, so Chapter 18 tackles this hidden issue. Part 6. The Part of Tens. The Part of Tens is a For Dummies classic, so of course this book includes it as well. Chapter 19 clues you in to important questions to ask before signing an LOI. In Chapter 20, I warn you against mistakes that can sink a deal. And Chapter 21 offers ways to come to an agreement on valuation. Icons used in this book. I use the following four icons throughout this book to help draw your attention to particularly important or salient bits of information and let you know what bits aren't essential. You will hear the icon verbalized in this audio edition. Tip. This icon denotes info that can save you time and/or hassle as you work through a deal. Remember. The Remember icon flags important points and concepts worth searing into your memory banks. Technical stuff. This icon is useful but not vital to the topic at hand. You can skip it if you're in a hurry or just want the need-to-know information. Warning. I use this icon to highlight potential M&A disasters you want to avoid. Where to go from here? No matter your immediate interests or needs, I highly recommend reading Chapter 3, which provides an overview of the process, an understanding of the typical steps involved in a business sale can help you as you read other specific sections. From there, you can dive in and out of this book as you please. You will also find a handy cheat sheet for this book on dummies.com. Just search for Mergers and Acquisitions for Dummies cheat sheet from the dummies.com homepage. Beyond this book, the best advice I can offer for anyone who wants to buy or sell companies or work as an advisor in the M&A industry is to get off your duff and get in the game. Books are great, and I certainly hope you find Mergers and Acquisitions for Dummies to be an extremely valuable resource, but the fact remains that the best way to learn something is to do it yourself. The only way you can truly get a handle on buying and selling companies is to actually buy and sell companies. I'm a big believer in ground-up learning. No, I'm not talking about deli meats. I'm talking about getting your hands dirty and learning business from the ground up. You're going to make mistakes, but finding out what doesn't work is the best way to learn. If you want to be successful in M&A as a buyer, a seller, or an intermediary, you're best served if you can talk from a level of actual experience. Those experiences should ideally include successfully selling a product or service, interacting with customers, hiring and firing employees, merchandising, marketing, working in human resource compliance, banking, making a payroll, filing taxes and bookkeeping. Mopping some floors and scrubbing a few toilets won't kill you either. You don't want to be the only one at the table who hasn't dealt with real-world business issues and problems. Being the least qualified person in the room is never a good thing. One of the big ironies for the investment banking world is that most people who do what I do didn't start their careers with the plan of being an investment banker. I'm often asked how to get into the investment banking industry. I always say the same thing. Most of us who do this didn't choose this career. Go do something else, get involved in a business first, and then segue into investment banking. One final thought. One of the keys to M&A is accounting. If your accounting skills are suspect or non-existent, you need to take a class, STAT. Most community colleges offer accounting classes, and you can probably audit the class instead of taking it for credit. Part 1. Mergers and Acquisitions 101. In this part delves into the basics of M&A, the players, their motivations, the terms, the nomenclature, the conventions of the industry, and the rules and regulations. I also discuss reasons to buy or sell a company, and I walk you through the generally accepted process of buying or selling a company on a step-by-step basis. Chapter 1. The Building Blocks of Mergers and Acquisitions. In this chapter, becoming familiar with the main vocabulary of mergers and acquisitions, understanding the rules of the road, opening your eyes to potential costs, figuring out where your company fits. Mergers and acquisitions is a complicated field, so this chapter provides a basic overview, an introduction to the basic terms and phrases, a discussion of decorum, and the basic M&A process, a look at the players and the category of deals, and my handy-dandy guide to helping business owners determine what kind of businesses they have. Defining mergers and acquisitions. Mergers and acquisitions, or M&A for short, the M&A world is rife with acronyms and initialisms, is a bit of a catch-all phrase. For all intents and purposes, M&A simply means the buying and selling of companies. When you think about it, mergers and acquisitions aren't different. They're simply variations on the same theme. In the strictest sense, a merger is a combination of two or more entities where each merging entity has an equal stake in the new enterprise, and each merging entity has a very clearly defined role in the new entity. This ideal is the vaunted merger of equals. Daimler's 1998 combination with Chrysler was a merger of equals. In a more practical sense, so-called mergers of equals are rare. One side usually ends up controlling the enterprise. For example, the years following the Daimler-Chrysler merger showed that Daimler executives planned all along to control the combined entity. Although actual mergers do occur, most of the activity in the M&A world centers on one company buying another company, or the acquisitions category. I like to think using the word merger keeps the uninitiated on their toes. Plus, talking about combining two companies as equal partners rather than about committing a hostile takeover sounds much more egalitarian. Mergers are far less common than acquisitions. An acquisition is when one company buys another company. A division of another company, or a product line, or certain assets from another company. Actually, an acquisition is when any kind of business purchases another part or all of another business. Although some companies grow organically from within by creating and selling products or services, an acquisition allows a company to bypass the growth stage by simply buying existing sales and profits. Starting up a new product line may be less expensive than buying an existing one, but the market may take a while to adapt to the new product, if it does at all. For this reason, buying other companies rather than relying on organic growth may make sense for a particular company. The fact that one can transfer a company's ownership through a sale often comes as a bit of surprise to many people, including many business owners, believe it or not. Business owners, especially owners of middle market and lower middle market companies, with revenues between $250 million and $1 billion, middle market, and between $20 million and $250 million, lower middle market, have spent their careers building a company, so the process of selling a business is often something new and foreign to them. In addition to being an activity, M&A is an industry. As this book illustrates, the steps to doing a deal, the names of documents and processes, The conventions and the sundry tips and insights I provide are all based on de facto industry standards that have developed over time, and my humble hope is that this book helps introduce you to those standards and conventions. Introducing important terms and phrases. Like any topic, M&A has a language that you have to get a handle on to understand the field. Although I introduce many more terms and phrases throughout the book, the following words are part of the basic building blocks of M&A. Remember, the lingua franca of M&A is an amalgam of accounting and banking terms sprinkled with initialisms, acronyms, and words and phrases adjusted and twisted to suit certain needs at certain times. Pay close attention to the terms I define throughout the book. Although some are tricky, I use them all for a reason. Buyer. You can't sell something unless you have a buyer for it. Although buyers, both potential and actual, are typically companies or entities, I often refer to them as individuals for clarity. Remember, in documents and contracts and agreements, you usually see buyer as a defined term, which means it's capitalized. When you read those documents, buyer looks like the name of a person. In fact, to make it seem really formal, M&A professionals often drop the word "the" from buyer. Buyer isn't a one-size-fits-all category. A buyer may acquire all or part of a company, the stock of the company, or certain or all assets, and even assume some of the liabilities. Despite this wide variety of possibilities, buyers typically fall into four broad types. Strategic buyers. These buyers are other companies planning to combine operations of the two companies to some extent, as opposed to buying strictly for financial reasons. For example, when Oracle buys a company, Oracle is considered a strategic buyer because it buys companies that have some sort of synergy to its business. Financial buyers. Financial buyers are funds of money that buy companies. Financial buyers of middle market and lower middle market companies are typically private equity, PE, funds, which are essentially large pools of money. See Chapter 4 for more. Other companies backed by PE funds. The company will be the new owner of the acquired company, but another entity, the fund, is providing the dough to do the deal. Individuals. Although it happens, an individual buying a middle market or lower middle market company is rare. When individuals do buy companies, those companies tend to be small retail shops, consulting firms, or construction companies. Typically, these companies have revenues of less than $1 million. Remember, as a seller, know that who's on the other side of the negotiating table may change the way your M&A process works. Are the buyers experienced deal people, or are they new to the process? For example, if your buyer is a PE firm, rest assured that the people you are negotiating with know exactly what they're doing. Seller. You can't buy something unless you have a seller. Like buyers, sellers usually aren't individuals, though I often refer to them in the singular here for clarification purposes. Seller is a defined term meaning it's capitalized for the purposes of documents and contracts. Here's a quick look at the types of sellers you may find in the world of M&A. The spin-off. A company may be divesting a division, a product line, or certain assets. The change of control. This company is selling enough of itself, more than 50%, to result in a change of control. In these cases, the owner or owners most likely receive the money, Colloquially, this approach is called taking some chips off the table. The recap. Sometimes an owner wants to take some chips off the table without giving up control of the company. This situation is called a recapitalization, or recap for short. The growth capital. A seller may issue more stock for the purposes of raising capital to invest in the business. In this case, the owner isn't actually selling the company, but rather selling more stakes in the company. The money from the sale doesn't flow to the owner. Instead, the company retains the money to fund growth. Remember. Remembering why the seller is selling the company, how much of the company he or she is selling, and where the money goes is key. Follow the money. M&A personality types. Regardless of whether you're buying or selling, one helpful trick for getting deals done is to assess the personality of your negotiating counterpart. Based on my experience, you're liable to run across the following types of people. The highly motivated. This person has to get a deal done or he's doomed. He's so desperate to do a deal that he may, strike that, will, leave dollars on the table. The ruler of the universe business magnate. He's from experienced, wily, and cagey LTD. He's made countless deals and knows exactly what he's doing. If you find yourself matched against this person, look out. The worst thing you can do is to turn into the highly motivated. You'll get your clock cleaned. The know-it-all who's never sold a company. This person is one of the potential problem children of the M&A world. Quite often, he's an expert in one field, and thus thinks he's an expert in everything. The best way to counteract this type of person is by asking questions, reasoning, and getting him to explain his point of view. Avoid simply saying no if you don't like his proposal. Challenge him. Your only hope of changing this person's mind is getting him to change it himself. Mr. Irrational. Mr. Irrational is the insane twin of the know-it-all, except without the strong logic skills. As a result, employing logic and reason doesn't work. An irrational person is difficult to work with, so your ability to get a deal done is limited. Give it your best shot and then walk away when the proceedings begin to get petty and frustrating. Interestingly enough, these irrational people often come to their senses after the heat of the battle fades. Don't fuel their irrationality with endless negotiating and discussions. The earnest first-timer. The country cousin of the know-it-all and Mr. Irrational. This person is so intent on doing everything letter perfectly that he misses the proverbial forest for the trees. Work to get this person to do as you want, or he'll end up irritating you to no end. The professional. Typically, this type is the best person to work with. He's a deal pro who's been around the block many times, leaves emotion out of the negotiation, and works to close a deal on mutually beneficial terms. The chronic negotiator. This exhausting individual negotiates and fights for excruciatingly minor details over and over again. Although attention to detail is important and worth the hassle, endlessly negotiating those details eventually evokes the law of diminishing returns. You put in more time for smaller and smaller advancements. At some point, the nitpicky details aren't worth the hassle. This person blasts through that point. The renegotiator. Don't confuse this person with the chronic negotiator, though the same person can be both. This guy's MO is to wait until the deal is seemingly done before asking or demanding that you change the terms. Don't give in. Changing the deal at the last minute comes back to haunt you because you may be needlessly agreeing to concessions. Don't let the rush of closing a deal cloud your decision-making. Transaction, also known as the deal. The transaction is when buyer sells a company to seller. It's an abstract concept, as in, we're working on a transaction that will sell ABC to XYZ. It can also refer to the finished sale. We completed the transaction yesterday. Don't confuse the transaction with the purchase agreement, a contract that memorializes the transaction. See Chapter 15 for more on this document. Remember, transaction is a more formal version of deal. Most documents, agreements, and contracts use the word transaction, often capitalized as a defined term, but conversations and emails may use deal and transaction interchangeably. Think of deal as transaction's popular cousin, from the wrong side of the tracks. Consideration. Consideration is what seller receives from buyer as a result of selling the business. In its most obvious form, the consideration is cash, but cash is not the only way to pay for a business. Buyer may issue stock to seller in exchange for the business. Seller may accept a note from buyer. Buyer promises to pay later. Or perhaps the price of the business is contingent, and buyer pays seller an earn-out based on the performance of the business after the transaction's completion. Remember, consideration is not an either-or situation. In other words, the consideration may consist of some cash at closing, stock in the acquiring company, and an earnout. Or perhaps the consideration is a note plus an earnout. No single right or wrong way to structure a deal exists. Structuring a deal by using various forms of consideration is similar to twisting the knobs on a stereo. To get it just right, you may have to increase the bass and turn down the treble. Chapter 4 provides a much deeper dive into the ways buyers can finance deals. Consideration is usually a defined term and therefore capitalized in documents and so forth. EBITDA. EBITDA. Earnings before interest, tax, depreciation, and amortization is one of those horrible business jargon terms, but it's unavoidable in M&A. EBITDA and its variations form the basis for most deals. EBITDA is the cash flow of a company without accounting for interest payments or interest income, tax bills, and certain non-cash expenses, depreciation and amortization. In other words, EBITDA measures the cash generated from doing what the company is supposed to do, sell its goods or services. So why is this number so gosh darn important? EBITDA is often but not always the basis a company uses to determine its valuation, see Chapter 12, and is often a defined term in the agreements and contracts. Banks quite often include EBITDA as one of the covenants for making a loan. Technical stuff. EBITDA is commonly pronounced EBITDA, and in case you're wondering, EBITDA is not a generally accepted accounting principles GAAP term. Neither is adjusted EBITDA, which I cover in the following section. However, both EBITDA and adjusted EBITDA are perfectly acceptable terms for the purposes of M&A activities. Adjusted EBITDA. Adjusted EBITDA, which is EBITDA's wild and crazy cousin, is simply EBITDA with adjustments. For example, a business owner often takes a salary, larger than industry standards, so a buyer may want to add back part of that salary to arrive at a more reasonable level of earnings. Say the owner of a company with $20 million in revenue receives total compensation of $500,000 when the industry standard for the president of a like-sized company is $250,000. In this case, adding $250,000 plus the prorated amount of income tax back to the EBITDA figure makes sense. Other adjustments to EBITDA may include add-backs for other owner-related expenses, cars, gas, cell phone, country club, health club, and so on. If certain employees won't be part of the business after the deal is complete, adding back their salaries and corresponding payroll tax and benefits expenses is appropriate. No set standard exists for adjusted EBITDA. Adjusted EBITDA is whatever buyer and seller agree it is. Warning. Although running certain personal expenses through a business may be common, the practice may run afoul of the IRS. Consult with your tax advisor for the proper treatment of personal expenses. Closing. Closing is what buyer and seller dream of. It's why we M&A folks do what we do. In fact, it's so important that I devote an entire chapter, chapter 16, to closing. In a nutshell, closing is the day when buyer hands off the consideration to seller and seller hands off the company to buyer. Adhering to basic M&A rules and decorum. Knowing the M&A language is important, but understanding the rules of the M&A game and the decorum for its participants is equally important. Much like a poker game, the actions, the inactions, the movements, the gestures, in other words, the tells, are hugely important in the world of buying and selling companies. Warning. If you're going to get into the M&A business, you have to know what to do and what to expect. Those caught off guard are those who won't be successful. Simple as that. Inadvertently and incorrectly broadcasting yourself as an M&A amateur can be hazardous to the health of your deal. Follow the steps to getting a deal done. Remember that the M&A process is a serial process. Transactions follow a step-by-step process. The following list gives you an overview of that process. I strongly encourage you to check out Chapter 3, where I discuss the steps in more detail. Remember, even though M&A follows a step-by-step process, the process often isn't linear. It goes through unforeseen twists and turns, so you have to be able to adjust. 1. Compile a target list. For sellers, this means creating a list of potential buyers, and for buyers, this means a list of business owners who may be potential sellers. 2. Make contact with the targets. Reach out to an executive or owner of a company on your list from step 1. I prefer to make phone calls when contacting buyers and sellers. 3. Send a blind teaser if you're selling, or ask for an executive summary if you're buying. If both sides, buyer and seller, have some level of interest in exploring a deal after the initial contact, seller provides buyer with a little bit of info in the form of an anonymous teaser. That way, buyer isn't inundated with too much info, and seller maintains confidentiality and anonymity. 4. Sign a confidentiality agreement. In this legal document, buyer promises not to disclose seller's private information or even the fact that conversations about a potential transaction are ongoing. 5. Send an offering document if you're selling, or review the offering document if you're buying. The offering document is the deal book, the document that contains the information about the company for sale. A well-written offering document should contain enough information for a buyer to make an offer. 6. Ask for an indication of interest if you are selling, or submit one if you're buying. Buyer submits a simple letter expressing his interest in doing a deal. If the indication meets seller's approval, she invites buyer to a meeting. 7. Conduct management meetings. Management meetings give buyer and seller an opportunity to meet face-to-face. Seller provides buyer with updated figures from when the offering document was written, and based on this update, buyer may or may not submit a formal offer. 8. Ask for a letter of intent, LOI, if you're selling, or submit one if you're buying. The LOI is the formal offer. However, it's still non-binding, so each party can still walk away from the deal at this stage. 9. Participate in due diligence. Due diligence occurs after buyer and seller come to terms. During this step, buyer reviews, examines, and inspects seller's books, records, contracts, and more to verify that the seller's claims are accurate. 10. Craft a purchase agreement. During due diligence, buyer and seller write a purchase agreement to finalize the deal both sides negotiated. This document is final and legally binding. 11. Attend closing. After due diligence is complete and the purchase agreement is drafted, buyer and seller close the deal. Seller turns over the keys of the business to buyer. Buyer forks over money to seller. 12. Deal with post-closing adjustments and integration. A deal is not done the day it closes. In most cases, buyer and seller have some post-closing adjustments to navigate, and buyer has the task of integrating the two companies. Understand M&A etiquette. If you aren't careful, you can easily give off the wrong signal inadvertently due to your M&A proceedings. Failure to follow up quickly, return calls, and give complete answers is an easy way to turn off the other side and kill a deal. Show interest in doing a deal. If you're not interested in pursuing a deal, communicate that to the other side. Here are a few more quick pointers to help you make the best impression. Respond to a direct question with a direct answer. Sellers most often break this rule. Instead of addressing a basic question like, "What were revenues last year?" with a simple answer, seller decides to dive into a 15-minute monologue about something that sounds impressive. In this case, seller doesn't impress buyer. Buyer merely gets bored and may even wonder what seller is hiding. Don't put on airs. Sometimes one side is so intent on impressing the other side that it instead looks foolish, childish, or amateurish. The best course of action, just be yourself. Don't think you need to go out of your way to impress someone. Trying to impress someone rarely works and often backfires. If you don't know something, just say you don't know it. You're not going to impress the other side by talking about things you don't know. If you're not sure, simply say, "I need to check into that and get back to you." Remember, when you say you're going to do something, follow through and do it. No explanation needed. Know what to tell employees and when. Ambiguity is no one's friend. The disclosure to the outside world that a company is for sale can be a devastating bit of news. Competitors may pounce and try to steal customers by implying that the sale may impact product quality or through some other scare tactic. For this and many other reasons, news of a potential business sale should be a very closely guarded secret, known only to a select few until the time is right to make the announcement. Likewise, revealing a sale or impending sale to employees is a delicate, critical matter. The timing of such an internal announcement often depends on your situation and whether you're doing the buying or the selling. The following sections give you some insight into this important topic. When you're selling your company. If employees find out that their employer is for sale, they may get twitchy and nervous. The news that a company is for sale can cause key people to begin looking for work elsewhere. For this reason, sellers should tell employees about a potential sale on a strictly need-to-know basis. Tip: staggering the release of the business sale news is acceptable. Not everyone needs to learn the news at the same time. For example, key executives and managers need to know before lower-level employees. Exactly who that is depends on the specifics of each company. Generally, the CFO needs to know, and depending on the size of the firm, she may need to let certain key employees in on the secret. Financial disclosure is very important, and people in the accounting department can usually figure out when something is going on. They're suddenly inundated with very unusual and exacting requests for financial data. Remember, if an employee asks you about a rumor that the company is for sale, neither confirm nor deny the rumor, but never lie. If you tell the employee that the company is not for sale, and then the company makes a sale announcement 2 months later, that employee will feel betrayed and her trust will be broken. Instead, tell her that the owners are exploring some options, including bringing in investors to help take the company to the next level. When you're buying companies. For buyers, letting employees know that the company is seeking acquisitions has little downside. Think about it. How much harm can come from your competitors finding out that your company is so successful that you're exploring making acquisitions? Warning: treat the confidentiality clause in the confidentiality agreement very seriously. Loose lips sink ships. A sure way to scuttle a potential deal is for a buyer to talk about it with people who aren't part of the process. See Chapter 7 for more details about confidentiality. Considering the costs associated with M&A. Although the main cost in any M&A transaction is most likely the cost to acquire the company or assets, both buyers and sellers incur other costs. These costs range from the retinue of advisors needed to close deals, paying off debt, adjustments made after the close, and regrettably, taxes. Tallying advisors' fees and other costs. As I explain in Chapter 5, M&A dealmakers can't do the job alone. Any buyer or seller should retain a capital M&A advisor, investment banker, a lawyer, and an accountant. These people don't work for free, so their charges are part of the expenses of doing a deal. Of course, advisor fees vary based on the deal and how much work the advisor does, but here are some very general guidelines. A lawyer may charge anywhere from $25,000 to more than $100,000. An accounting firm may charge anywhere from $25,000 to $75,000. Investment banking fees vary, but in a very general sense, you should expect to pay roughly 3% to 10% of the transaction value. Some deals involve other costs as well, including a real estate appraisal, an environmental testing, a database and IT examination, and a marketing analysis. Fees vary, of course, but all these functions likely cost anywhere from $10,000 to more than $100,000 apiece. Remember, this section may seem a bit wide open, but nailing down the cost without knowing the deal is impossible. The best way to get a concrete estimate of a particular deal's fees is to speak with advisors and ask them to ballpark their expenses. Tip: if you're worried about fees spiraling out of control, negotiate a flat fee or a capped fee from your advisors if possible. Not all will be willing to do this arrangement. If you get pushback, you can always agree that if the advisor does the work for a flat fee now, you'll give him the ongoing legal or accounting work post-transaction. Paying off debt. One of the areas that sellers often overlook is the debt of the business. Unless stipulated, a buyer doesn't assume the debt. If a company has $5 million in long-term debt, and the company is being sold for $20 million, the seller needs to repay that debt, thus reducing the proceeds to $15 million. Post-closing adjustments. Another area that sellers often don't think about is the adjustments made to the deal after closing. Most often, this is in the form of a working capital adjustment, which occurs when the working capital, receivables and inventory minus payables, on the estimated balance sheet seller provides at closing doesn't match up with the actual balance sheet as of closing that the buyer prepares at a later agreed-upon date, usually 30 to 60 days after closing. Buyer and seller do a working capital adjustment to true up, reconcile their accounts. This adjustment is typically, though not always, minor. If the actual working capital comes in lower than the estimate, seller refunds a bit to buyer, often by knocking some money off the purchase price. If the figure comes in higher than the estimate, buyer cuts seller a check. Say buyer agrees to pay $10 million for a business and that buyer and seller agree that working capital has averaged $2 million. If seller's estimated balance sheet shows working capital to be $1.5 million, seller has to provide buyer with $500,000. With a working capital adjustment, buyer just pays seller $9.5 million rather than $10 million. Why take working capital adjustments? Simply put, working capital is an asset, and if less of that asset is delivered at closing, buyer is due a discount from the agreed-upon purchase price and vice versa. Without a working capital adjustment, seller would have every incentive to collect all the receivables, even if done at deep discounts, sell off all the inventory, and stop paying bills, thus inflating payables. Buyer would take possession of a business that has been severely hampered by the previous owner. Buyer then has to spend money to rebuild inventory and pay off old bills, and doesn't have the benefit of receivables. Sigh. Talking taxes. Sellers often forget that they likely face capital gains tax on the business sale. That's one reason sellers generally prefer stock deals. A stock deal likely has a lower amount of tax. For many, but not all sellers, an asset deal exposes them to double taxation. The proceeds are taxed at the time of the sale, at the company level, and then the owner pays again when the company transmits the proceeds to her. Chapter 15 gives you the lowdown on stock and asset deals. Remember, speak to your financial advisor about your specific tax situation. Determining what kind of company you have. As I state throughout the book, mergers and acquisitions for dummies is primarily for sellers or buyers of middle market and lower middle market companies. But what exactly constitutes those types of companies, and how do you define other company types? The distinction has to do with size, most often revenues and profits. Then, you have the issue of critical mass. Critical mass is a subjective term, and it simply means size. Does the company have enough employees, revenues, management depth, clients, and so on to survive a downturn? Smaller businesses most often do not have enough critical mass to be of interest to acquirers. Capital providers, who may be able to help finance acquisitions, will have little or no interest too. Although critical mass differs for different companies, in a general sense, a company with $30 million in revenue and $3 million in profits has a better chance of surviving a $1 million reduction in profits than a smaller firm with only $500,000 in profits. If you're thinking about chasing acquisitions or selling your business, understanding where your business fits is important. Who may be interested in acquiring it? Definitions vary, but for the purposes of this book, I've divided the market into sole proprietorship, small business, lower middle market company, and large company, and beyond. Sole proprietorship. Sole proprietorships are companies with revenues of less than $1 million. They're your neighborhood pizza joints, corner bars, clothing boutiques, or small legal or accounting practices. Although these businesses are viable going concerns, aren't facing liquidation in the near future, and often trade hands, they're too small to be of interest to PE firms and strategic buyers, as well as corresponding service providers who assist in M&A work. Why are sole proprietorships of little or no interest to an acquirer? Simply put, buying a $1 million business and a $100 million business requires about the same amount of time and the same steps and expenses. So if you're going to go through the trouble of buying a company, you may as well get your money's worth and buy a larger concern. Making dozens of tiny acquisitions is just not worth the time or expense. Small business. Small businesses usually have annual revenues of $1 million to $10 million. These businesses are larger consulting practices, multi-unit independent retail companies, construction firms, and so on. Unless the company is incredibly profitable, profits north of $1 million, preferably $2 million or $3 million, small businesses are too small to be of interest to most strategic acquirers and PE funds. Technical stuff. Although PE funds and strategic acquirers are usually not interested in smaller companies, they occasionally make exceptions if a company has a unique technology or process. In these cases, the acquirer can take that technology or process and deploy it across a much larger enterprise, thus rapidly creating value. Middle market and lower middle market company. Lower middle market companies are companies with $10 million to $250 million in annual revenue. Middle market companies have revenues of $250 million to $500 million. These companies typically have enough critical mass to be of interest to both strategic acquirers and PE funds. Also, because these deals are larger than small business and sole proprietorship deals, M&A transaction fees are large enough to justify the involvement of an investment banking firm. Large companies and beyond. Companies with revenues north of $500 million are considered large, huge, gigantic, and if revenues are well into the billions, Fortune 500. Although transactions are typically very large, the fact is very few companies are large. The middle and lower middle markets are far larger. Firms in this category typically use bulge bracket investment banks. These entities are the largest of most sophisticated of investment banks. They also charge enormous fees. Technical stuff. The term bulge bracket originates from the placement of a firm's name on a public offering statement. Public offerings of securities typically involve multiple firms, and the largest firms or managers of the offering want their names to the left, away from the names of the smaller firms. The placement of the names looks as if they were bulging, hence the moniker. Chapter 2. Getting ready to buy or sell a company. In this chapter, knowing why companies often sell or buy other companies. Preparing your company to engage in M&A. On seller's side, the conversation begins with any one of numerous comments. I think it's time to retire. Or, I've taken this company as far as I can take it. Or maybe even, this company's about to crater, I want to get out. On buyer's side, the conversation also begins with any one of numerous comments, but comments of a slightly different variety. Organic growth isn't enough. We need to consider growth through acquisitions. Or, I think buying that product line might be easier and less expensive than building one from scratch. Or maybe even, those guys are killing us. Let's see if we can buy them out. These conversations are often held with advisors, lawyers, accountants, wealth managers, or other executives. Most often, a set of questions follows. How do we do this? What's the first step? And finally, do you know anyone who can help us? The decision to sell a business or to make an acquisition is often confusing, frustrating, time-consuming, and expensive. But never fear. In this chapter, I break down the early considerations for selling or buying a company so that they feel less intimidating. Considering common reasons to sell. Many people, including many business owners, think the cash flow from a business is the only source of wealth creation. They overlook the quite often stunning wealth that company ownership can create. This section explores the reasons an owner may want to sell his business. Warning. Trying to time the market, that is to say, trying to set your transaction to close when the economy is roaring, rarely works. Instead of trying to guess when buyers are going to pay high prices, sellers should focus on running the business, increasing sales, controlling costs, and improving profits. The best time to sell a company is at the intersection of saleability and the need or want to sell the business, and not necessarily when the market is booming. Retirement. Retirement is one of the top reasons business owners decide to sell their businesses. The older some people get, the more they hear the siren call of Florida or Arizona, or the Carolinas, or, well, any place that doesn't involve work sounds enticing. When an owner is considering moving on to the next phase of life, that phase of life often is fueled by the proceeds from selling his business. So the question then becomes, how do I know when it's time to retire? Here are some typical issues business owners consider when deciding whether to head off into the sunset. Family. Where are the kids? At home, in college, on their own? Are you still supporting them? Or are they financially independent? Lifestyle. What do you want to do? Get involved with charities, golf, boat, travel, spend time with the grandkids. How much vacation time are you taking each year? If you're spending increasing amounts of time away from the business and the business can operate without you, a good thing if you want to sell it. Retirement time may be nigh. Finances. Do you have enough saved to fund the lifestyle you want? Have you actually figured out that number with a professional planner, or are you just guessing? Tip. As far as funding retirement, business owners usually have a rough back-of-the-envelope number in their heads. Many times that number is little more than a guess, and that guess often is a gross overstatement of what the owner really needs to fund his retirement. Sit down with a qualified wealth manager and talk about exactly what you want to do in retirement. That wealth manager should be able to determine what you'll need to retire and live exactly as you want to live. Your personal drive. Be honest. How's your energy and drive? Yeah, I know that sounds like one of those pharmaceutical commercials, but in all seriousness, are you still the go-getter who originally built the business? Admitting that your drive isn't what it once was, and that you're putting aside your ego to think about what's best for the business and your employees, is no cause for shame. If your position is no longer necessary to support the family, you have enough to retire, your lifestyle interests are increasingly outside the confines of work, and you've simply lost your mojo and desire for work, perhaps you're ready to think about selling the business and retiring. Tip. Buyer, you can ask a reluctant seller if she has planned her retirement with a qualified professional. Getting an owner to create a concrete retirement plan with an advisor can be a way to bridge a valuation gap. See chapters 12 and 21 for more on valuation and bridging valuation gaps. Let someone else take the company to the next level. Some owners choose to sell because they've determined that they've taken the business as far as they can take it. They may not want to retire, but they also may not want to run the same company anymore. This situation happens for a few reasons. Capital needs. A growing company, even a highly profitable company, usually requires more capital than the business generates from operating cash flow. Why is that? For most companies, cash flow lags behind revenue recognition, and revenue recognition lags behind expenditures required to support that revenue. A growth company that constantly needs to reinvest in the business, new employees, equipment and supplies, and so on, essentially has the capital needs of a much larger enterprise. Owners often decide they're no longer willing to put their money at risk, and as such, they're ready for another owner, perhaps a larger, better capitalized entity, to swoop in and take the company to the next level. The segue. I'm not talking about those fancy two-wheeled scooters here. The segue refers to a natural phase during the life cycle of a company, the gradual shift from an entrepreneurial company to a professional company. As a company grows, it needs more people to manage, oversee, and support the company's new, larger size. With each new hire, the dynamic of the company changes. The entrepreneur or owner's influence on the corporate culture is diminished. This move isn't a bad thing, it's normal. The company, by necessity, has to shift from a centralized seat of the pants CEO is in on every decision organism into a diverse, decentralized, and highly structured entity. Many successful entrepreneurs simply don't have the ability or interest to design, implement, and run a highly structured company and thus begin to pine for the days of yore. At this point, bringing in a larger, professionally run entity may be the best way for the company to continue its upward growth. Chairman of the Board. The major battles are won. The company is on a great footing, and everyone knows his job and does it well. So where's the problem? Believe it or not, many business owners, especially those of the entrepreneurial stripe, grow exceedingly bored with a well-run company. In this situation, both the company and the owner may be better off if another, more engaged entity takes over. Remember, an owner selling his business so that someone else can take it to the next level isn't indicating that he can't run the business. He may be setting his sights on his next business venture. He may be one of the vaunted serial entrepreneurs you've undoubtedly heard about. The world of M&A is rife with them, and everyone is better off as a result because entrepreneurs create jobs, new products, and better services. Divesting a division or product line. An owner doesn't have to sell the entire company. Selling a division or a product line is a very common M&A activity. Some of the reasons to divest a division or product line include a bad acquisition. Here's a bit of irony for a book about M&A. Bad acquisitions are often the reason companies sell businesses, thus fueling a less than virtuous cycle for buyers, shareholders, of making acquisitions at high prices and then selling them off at low prices over and over and over. Sometimes buyer is too large and the acquired company gets lost in the shuffle and declines from lack of focus and support from the parent. Other times the acquired company suffers as a result of bad decisions by buyer. I've seen far too many acquired companies go downhill because buyer decided to cut costs by firing the sales staff. Getting rid of the sales staff often has the effect of, surprise, surprise, reducing revenue. As the acquired company declines because of these bad decisions, it may start to lose money to the extent that buyer eventually seeks to cut its losses by divesting the acquisition. An over-leveraged buyer. Sometimes buyer borrows too much money to finance the acquisition, and the slightest hiccup in the economy can impair the acquired firm, thus forcing buyer to sell off the acquired company. Actually, buyer's lending sources most often force the issue when buyer is unable to service the debt incurred to finance the acquisition. Buyer has to sell the acquisition often at a bargain basement price, or worse, the creditors may end up taking over the acquired business, resulting in a total loss for buyer. A money-losing division. The decision to sell a weak division is often very easy and straightforward, especially if the rest of the company is strong. Losses can drag down an otherwise strong company, so instead of throwing good money after bad, a company may simply spin off a money-losing division to get rid of it and its offending losses. A lack of synergy. Sometimes 1 plus 1 equals 3. Many other times, the grand plan of combining two entities doesn't pan out. For example, say a marketing services company starts up a janitorial services division. Most likely, the parent company will discover two divisions in disparate markets are spreading the company too thin. The best course of action may be to sell off one of the offending divisions and focus on the core strengths of the company. In the hands of the correct owner, divested divisions often rebound quickly, far from being the bad gift that just keeps on giving. Selling off a division or product line that doesn't fit with Company A may be a perfect fit in the hands of Company B. The industry is changing. The decision to sell a company in the face of a changing competitive landscape is often a very smart move, but it's a difficult move because forecasting the future is so darn difficult. When people wanted to forecast the future in days of old, they would observe the flight patterns of birds and then make up something. Today, folks read newspapers and the internet, follow their gut instincts, and try to guess what's going to happen next. Timing the market can be a dangerous pursuit, but if a business owner believes the future involves technology developments that will render his company a has-been or worse, obsolete, he may be ready to exit the industry by selling the business. Remember, for buyers, changes in the industry are always a risk. Just ask any newspaper about how the internet changed the way news is disseminated. I've got troubles, troubles, troubles. In the How Did I Get Here file, you find the troubled children of the M&A world, often known as troubled companies, special situations, challenged companies, and turnaround opportunities. Troubled companies run the gamut, from handyman's specials that just need a little TLC to those that should be in bankruptcy. A company that is suffering from poor management decisions but remains a going concern, liquidation is not on the horizon, may make a suitable acquisition for an acquirer well-versed in turnaround work. On the other end of the spectrum, a company that is no longer a viable going concern should probably be liquidated by an orderly bankruptcy. Although the reasons a company becomes troubled are virtually limitless, you can pool them into three distinct buckets. Changes in the macroeconomy. A general downturn in the economy, much like the one experienced in the latter years of the first decade of the new millennium, often has a chilling effect on many companies, including those that are fundamentally sound. An otherwise healthy company that has been beaten up by the market, suffered declining revenues and profits, is often a great acquisition for a savvy acquirer. Managerial mistakes. Companies can suffer a downturn at the hands of poor management. Bad managerial decisions may or may not be tied to the general economy and include overextending the company's operations by opening too many new locations, often the second location constitutes too many, making bad hires, neglecting to reinvest in the company, throwing company resources after a bad idea, and failing to participate in a new trend in the industry. Remember, the good news is a company that has made managerial errors, similar to those listed here, may make a great pickup for the smart acquirer. The bad news is a company suffering through a series of near-fatal managerial mistakes may have burned bridges with its customers or suppliers. Consider yourself warned. Changes in customer preferences. In the world of troubled companies, those affected by this situation are the most troubled of them all. Think of the proverbial story about buggy whip manufacturers in the wake of the advent of the automobile. Sometimes technology passes by a product. Regardless of the product's quality, companies can't do much to regain market share when customers move on to new and better products. The word for this phenomenon is disintermediation. Tip: if you own a troubled company, speak to your attorney and an M&A advisor about how to proceed with a potential M&A transaction. You may need to consider accepting a deal below your dream price because holding out for a better future deal is risky. That better deal may never materialize, and the clock is ticking on the longevity of a troubled company. Is this company worth the trouble? In addition to considering the nature of the target's downturn, macroeconomic, managerial, or changes in customer preferences, see the nearby section, a wise buyer also looks at a few other key considerations when determining the value, if any, of a troubled company. Is the target still profitable? If profits are down, perhaps even greatly down, but the target is still break-even or better, a buyer will be able to ride out the storm because the acquisition is not burning cash and wait for the economy to pick up. After the economy turns around, the acquired company's bottom line will be in position to snap back to its previous, higher levels.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.